Jesus to fully praise you. It will take all eternity, just like Lazarus. Oh, you brought me back.
Sing it out, hey, oh, 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 to break. At the sound of our voices, at the sound of our praise. Mountains, get out of our way. Morning, church. After a long, tiring week, how good it is to be found in the house of the Lord. Amen? You know, every time we gather, what is the attitude we must have when we come into this sanctuary? It's an attitude of praise, of worship, of thanksgiving, of joy, of praises. There's so many things to be grateful for. Psalm 63, David says, "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and behold your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. I will be fully satisfied as with the riches of food. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you." Come, let us just be in a heart of an attitude of praise and worship. Let's welcome the presence of the Lord to fill this place. Father, we acknowledge that you are the Lord, worthy of all our praises, all our love, all our adoration. Father, this morning as we gather in this place, we ask, Lord, that may your presence come and fill this sanctuary. Come and be with us, Lord. Father, I lift up the worship team before you. I pray, Lord, that may you anoint them, may you touch them, may they lead us all into your very presence, Lord. Father, I lift up Reverend James before you, that as he breaks the word of life, may the words be powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, Lord, that it touch hearts, touch souls, touch our lives, Lord. So, Father, this morning, as we gather in this place, we invite you, Lord, to come and be the center of it all. We ask all this in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And good morning, church. Good morning. Good morning. Let's lift up the name of Jesus here in this place and let us worship him in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together and let's look to him. To you, Lord, who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the holy with holy thunder, who leaves us breath. King above all kings, this is amazing. we sing. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
The King who conquered the grave.
Your grace has found me.
The one who has founded everything, Lord. Father, we declare that you are indeed the one that we worship in this church, in this sanctuary, and in this place, Father. We shall touch of the hem of your garment, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your presence in this place. We declare, Lord, that your name be high and lifted up in this place. And everybody say, amen and amen. Please be seated. Today being the third Sunday of the month, we shall have a communion. And can I invite Pastor Leon to come and lead us in communion?
Good morning. Glad to be back after a fruitful and successful mission to Angeles City. We came back on Tuesday night. Later, Pastor Joe will give you a report. But for now, let's quieten our hearts. We'll prepare for to partake of this Holy Communion. This is a privilege extended only to the members of God's family. So if you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, please abstain. This is strictly for Christians, for followers of Jesus Christ. Let's prepare the emblem. Let's lift up this bread. Dear Heavenly Father, indeed, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. He, Jesus, my Lord, was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes, we are healed. And we want to say thank you, Jesus, because our sins pinned you to the cross. You bore that which was meant for us. And your body was broken that we can be made whole. And you died so that we may live abundant life now and eternal life forever. And we say thank you. So even as we partake of this bread, we do so in remembrance of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's eat. Let's lift up the cup. Dear Heavenly Father, we cannot imagine the pain and the shame and the full sacrifice that our Lord Jesus did for us. He shed his precious blood that we might be washed clean, sanctified and consecrated for him, and our sins totally forgiven. Nothing that we could achieve on our own, but purely by your grace and your mercy. And we want to say, thank you, Jesus. So as we partake of this cup, we do so in remembrance of Jesus Christ. Amen.
To be in the house of the Lord. Amen. And welcome to those who have joined us this morning online as well. Good morning. Greetings from Bethesda Cathedral. Today, let's welcome those who are visiting us for the first time. Do we have any friends or people who is joining us for the first time today? Would you like to put up your hands so we can welcome you, give you a BC welcome? Or we have Sister Luciana Mashani from Indonesia, I believe. She has visited us today. So those around her can just welcome her. Anyone else? Do we have any other new friends who are here this morning? Welcome, sister. So it's always good to welcome friends who are visiting us for the first time. As Pastor Leong said, 22 of our members went to Angeles City. I missed my wife for a few days, but she came back with a lot of good testimony, good stories. So at this time, I'd like to invite Pastor Joe to come and share some of the highlights of the trip with us.
Good morning. Good to be back here. I just want to give a report, okay, on the 10th to the 14th of March, okay? If the slides can come up. We had such an impactful trip, you know. The unity that I see on the trip was so, so encouraging. And we just had such a fruitful trip. So there's 22 of us in total. And it makes up of not just Singaporean, but four sisters from the Philippines joined us in the Philippines. So total of 22 of us. And what was amazing is there is seven generations in this trip. The oldest is 70 years old. And the youngest is 14 years old. Amen? And it is just so encouraging to see the young and the old doing the work of God. We visited 10 villages. Man, some of the village, the team have to climb up. Some of us have to cross river. And it's just a time, just journeying with God as we serve the Lord. What do we do? Basically, we serve in three areas, okay? The first area is we preach and we give testimony. Some of us, some of the team is the first time giving testimony. Some of the team is the first time preaching. But all of them are so encouraged because they realize that God can use their gift. Amen? The second area that we did was children ministry. We serve the children. Everywhere we go, there's just so much children. And later you will see a video that the media team has put together. The third area is that we serve the poor, the needy, the mercy ministry. So for this report, you know, we gave out 940 food packs. Amen? And we just blessed all the villagers. Amen? Praise God. Praise God. And we gave out 450 reading glasses. So a lot of the places that we go, they just cannot read, cannot sew, okay? Cannot sew. So the reading glasses really help a lot. And salvation. In total, we have two scribes, okay, in the team. 210 people came to know Jesus. Amen! Amen. Hallelujah! Amen! And multiple more rededicate their life to Jesus. Amen. It was just such a powerful time. And for the kids, 259 kids give their life to Jesus. Praise God. Amen. And without further ado, the media team worked really hard. You know, we came back last Wednesday and they worked hard. And I just want to show this video and that it sums up the whole trip. Okay, let's play the video.
My name is Audra. I have been in BC for about 33 years. This is actually my first time going for a mission trip. They have guided really well in the last few sessions of what needs to be done, talking about getting your testimony ready. You know, sometimes we have our own testimony, but you know, when you have to actually share it to a crowd, it's different. It's relying on the Holy Spirit and asking the Holy Spirit, what do you want me to share? Because it's really not what I have to say. Right, it's really what God wants the people to hear. Be gracious, Lord,
there's nothing like being in the country itself and being at the place itself, because you will never know unless you are here.
I expect God to do what He wants to do, and I pray that my heart will be open to receive it. Yeah.
Every mission is different. Over the years, I've seen people that have never attended missions before, their eyes open, and something miraculous happened. Here I am, Lord. If it's loving one another, even when we don't agree. Here I am, Lord, send me.
never been away.
Sir, you just the same. Here I am, Lord. Send me on the mountain or the valley. I will choose to praise. Here I am, Lord. Send me.
If I know my how I love, let my life reflect how much I love you. I love you. And before you even ask, oh, my answer will be yes, as I love you. I love you. If the truth cuts like an arrow, I will say it anyway.
Really, the heart of the Father is that no person should be left out. Amen? And that's why we need to, as a church, as an individual, if we understand what mission is, it is to reach the last, the least, and the lost. And in a simple way, that's what mission is all about.
To bring the gospel, to bring the light to the lost.
Before you even ask, oh, my answer will be yes, as I love you, oh, I love you.
When I'm standing in your glory, I'll be glad I chose to say, here I am, Lord, send me. Well done, good and faithful, I live to hear you say, here I am, Lord, send me.
All we can do for them is really to bring the hope through Jesus, and Jesus is their hope.
And there's only one mission, and that is God loves everyone.
And I think we need more peace. And I think Singapore is blessed, and the others outside of Singapore need our blessings and to hear the gospels.
I hope to see new missionaries joining this team and join us in this mission trips. And not just in Philippines, we have Thailand and in Panga and in Rayon.
And you wouldn't want to miss this experience. It's not about you, it's not about anybody else, it's about the people and how we can bring the hope through Jesus to them.
Praise the Lord, amen. God is good. You know, I really want to thank Zilling and the media team. They really worked very hard over the last 3 days to get this video up. There's so much footage, but they worked really hard. Thank you. Thank you, Zilling and the media team. I also want to thank the church, amen. Thank you for praying, you know, because without prayer, we cannot go without prayer, amen. So we also want to thank everyone in the church for giving and contributing to all the food packs and everything. And also the last one, we want to thank everybody that has went for this trip. Because let's be a church that wants to be involved in mission, we must have people to pray, to send, and to go. Amen? And lastly, we just want to give God the highest glory for all that He has done. Thank you. Thank you. God bless.
Tell you a little bit of a secret. I was told that the food and this trip was quite good, actually. And it's not all just praying for people, I was also told that there's actually a bit of shopping thrown in as well. So for those who are planning for the next mission trip, okay, be prepared, bring some money also. Okay, so that is fantastic. That is Pastor Joe sharing about the trip, the mission trip that has just been completed. The next trip that is coming up. You know, when he first started his ministry, he walked along the Sea of Galilee and he called his disciples. Then when he sat down, so when you imagine what that would be like, right? Walking along the Sea of Galilee, what would he be doing? Then when he sat down at the mountainside and then he preached the sermon on the mount. Can you imagine we're talking in the open countryside? How did he project his voice? How was he able to make himself heard? Can you visualize that? Can you visualize that? So my first trip to Israel a couple of years back, I was taken aback at how lush, how green that place was. It's actually a beautiful place. You imagine that it'll be dry and arid, but Israel is such a green, lush little gem in the desert. Then you go to the mount, you sit down, then you can see, actually it is like a stadium, you know, where he stood, where we think Jesus stood when he speak. Actually, the voice carried through to the people. And you will never know until you are there. When you stood at the Mount of Olives, looking back at the Temple Mount, and imagine all the things that happened. When you go to the Museum of Jerusalem, when you see the Dead Sea Scroll, you see the big, what do you call that, the map or those model of Jerusalem in the past. It then drives home. What a beautiful, beautiful place. Israel is. Having said that, the next trip that is coming up in November this year, a bit of hard sell. We are planning a trip with Pastor Leong to Israel, departing in November. I'm told that there are still a few seats left. So for those people who have not been there, who have not seen, who has not seen the spot where Jesus was baptized, this is your chance. Sign up. I think there's probably a couple more seats left, a couple more months for you to sign up. Make your plans. We still have time. So get yourself registered and I'm very sure you will not regret going there. Okay? So that is the trip to Israel. Sign up as soon as you can. The next announcement, for those who are members of registered members of Bethesda Cathedral. So you have been baptized here, you are a registered member of Bethesda Cathedral. There is going to be, every year we have an AGM. So at the AGM this year, okay, we will be tabling an update to our constitution. So the constitution has not been reviewed, has not been updated since our founding in 1992. Okay, so it has been more than 30 years. So we are taking this year, we are taking the opportunity to review it, to update it, to make it current. So there will be quite a few significant changes to the constitution. So next week, Pastor Leong will update us on what are the key changes. So stay back after service next Sunday for those who are registered members of Bethesda. So delay your lunch plans a little bit. Stay back, it won't be long, but we will give you an update of what it is so that when you come for the EGM in April, okay, you will not be surprised. Okay? So those are the announcements for this week. So let's take our tithe and offering right now. Let's just commit our tithe and offering to the Lord. Father, we thank you for the works that you have done in our hearts and our lives. We thank you for the many blessings that you have given to us, that everything we have comes truly from you, Lord. So, Father, whatever we have, we return a portion back unto you. As we put it into the bag, Father, I pray for your blessings to be upon the giver. Give them grateful hearts. Give them joyful hearts. Make them joyful givers, that whatever they have been given, use it, bless it, multiply it, may it bring glory to you, Father. So we commit all of these things to you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people say, Amen. Are you ready for the word? So this morning, we have Reverend James Singh, who is an overseer from the Eagle's Nest Church. He is well known. He's an itinerant evangelist, well-known prophetic speaker, very anointed, very powerful. So if you put your hands together, let's welcome Reverend James to come to the pulpit.
Praise glory. Amen. Your Bible with you, let us turn to the book of Judges, chapter 2. Judges chapter 2 in your Bible. I'm reading from the black ink printed in white paper. If you have your electronic Bibles, you can turn it, but God bless them who use electronic Bible. But God loved them much more who use black ink and white paper, because in the beginning was not Samsung, but it was the Word of God. Let us turn to Judges chapter 2, verse 1 to verse 15. You got to open your Bible. We're going to follow through. As I began to pray, I just want to thank your pastor, the leadership, for this opportunity and humble privilege to minister the word of the Lord. I ask you for undivided attention to the word, and we began to seek the word of the Lord. And as I began to pray, the Lord began to lay upon my heart a message that I struggle myself to preach to you. I think it's a message that scared the daylight out of me. It's called Entitled and Apostasy. Judges chapter 2, reading from my Bible. And it says here, and the angel of the Lord came from Gilgal to Bochim. And he says, I lead you up from Egypt and brought you to the land which I swore to your fathers. And I say, I will never break my covenant with you. And you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. You shall tear down their altars, and you have not obeyed my voice. A very scary word. You have not obeyed my voice. Why have you done this? Therefore, I also say, I will not drive them out before you, and they shall be a thorn to your side, and the gorge shall be a snare to you. So it was when the angel of the Lord spoke these words unto all the children of Israel, the people lift up their voice and wept. Then they called the name of the place Bochim, and they sacrificed there to the Lord. When Joshua had dismissed the people, the children of Israel went each to his own inheritance to possess the land. So the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua, all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who have seen all the great works of the Lord which he have done before Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died when he was 110 years old. And they buried him within the borders of the inheritance of Tinnim Haris in the mountain of Ephraim on the north side of Mount Gash. When all the generation have been gathered to the fathers, another generation rose after them who did not know the Lord, nor the works which he had done for Israel. Let's repeat that statement again, that verse again. We're going to interact with the scripture. And he say, when all the generation had gathered to the fathers, another generation arose that did not know the Lord, nor the work and that he have done for Israel. Then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord and served Baals. And he forsook the Lord their God, Lord God of their fathers, who brought them out from the land of Egypt, followed after gods, among the gods of the people who were all around them, and they bowed down to them, and they provoked the Lord to anger. They forsook the Lord and served Baal and the Asherites. And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. So he delivered them into the hands of the plunderers, and who despoiled them, sold them into the hands of the enemy all around. So they could no longer stand before their enemy. Verse 15, whenever they went out, the hand of the Lord was against them for calamity and as the Lord has said, and as for the Lord has sworn to them, and they were greatly distressed. Leave your Bible open. I will not read all, but we leave the Bible open because we will interact with the word of the Lord. Let us open our hearts in prayer. Gracious Father, I come to you today in the mighty name of Jesus. Today, Lord, I ask you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit that will illuminate our mind to thy word, and every word that proceeds out of these lips will glorify your name. It is you that are worthy of praise and honor, O God. It is you that have received the glory. And today I ask of you, Father, right now, that you will not just become the hearers of the word, but become the doers of the word. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Today I entitled my message called Apostasy. Judges chapter 2, verse 1 to verse 19, in fact, or the whole chapter 2. But let me give you the context of this story. The book of Judges began with the journey of Israel, entering into the promised land. The instruction that the Lord gave was for them to claim back the land that the Canaanites have occupied. Still, that victory was incomplete because they did not drive out the Canaanites and the Jebusites that controlled Jerusalem. After seeing the incomplete victory, the angel of the Lord came to the house of Israel and say this word unto them. If you have the same Bible like mine, he will be the angel of a capital A. We will not go into the theophany because there's another subject to that. But I'd like to read that scripture again to you. And the Bible say in Judges chapter 2, verse 1 to verse 3, the angel of the Lord came to Gilgal to Bochim, and he say, I led you from Egypt and brought you to the land that I swore to your fathers, and I say, I will never break my covenant with you, and you shall have make no covenant with the inhabitants of the land. You shall tear down the altar, but you did not obey my voice. Why did you have done this? Therefore, I said, I will not drive them out before you, that they shall be their thorns on your side, and the gods shall be a snare to you. Essentially, this verse say that they should not have many alliance with these people. My dear brothers and sisters, Israel's problem was not a military problem. Israel's problem was not a technological problem. Israel's problem was a spiritual problem. And today, to claim the land was to be pure, sacred, and it was so desecrated, intermingled with a group of people that they were not meant to. So the angel of the Lord came, and because you have alliance yourself that you form, and you now, since you alliance with them, you live with them. This is a very hard word, and it become a snare to you, O Israel. Their foreign gods will be a snare. Israel, what does it mean? What does it mean to you, O Israel? I'm not scolding you, I'm talking to myself in the Bible. O Israel, what it mean to you? Let me tell you, O Israel, your potential and growth is going to be continually hindered. You cannot move forward in your destiny. I prepared for you. God will remove your growth, O Israel. This alliance will trap you to the point that you wish it never happened. You all look very serious at me. Let us pray again. If I need to pray 1,000 times, I will pray depending on the Holy Spirit of God. Because it's not me, but the Spirit of the Lord. We need the Holy Spirit to illuminate the word upon our hearts. The Holy Spirit will teach us thy word. We just haven't started yet. Father, I ask of you today, once again, I depend on you, Holy Spirit, that you teach us your word, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray, amen. Because of the wrong alliance, the current generation of Israel failed to educate the next generation about the things that is the things of God. Today, we look at Judges chapter 2, verse 10, when all the generation had gathered to the father, another generation rose that did not know the work of the Lord, nor what Israel had done. The Bible now say, because they did not know God, they died in the sin at the sight of the Lord. If you look to Judges chapter 2, verse 11 to verse 12, the Bible say, and the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and served Baal, they forsook the Lord, and their father, they brought them out of Egypt, they followed other gods and other gods, and you can see here, they bow down to them. Give me the slide. All right, I need the slide to show you the slide. All right, you give me the slide, I'll explain to you what happened. They were disobedient. There was a wrong alliance. There was zero impartation that leads to apostasy. Alliance, the word alliance is an interesting word in the Webster Dictionary, define an association to further common interests of member, union of relationship in quality. Many times we use this word in reference to nation, alliance with a common purpose. When a great conflict happened in the world, World War II, Gulf War, nation, friendly nation come together and say, these are the alliance. But we do not live in a vacuum, ladies and gentlemen. We live in a society, so we must align ourselves with other people with a common cause and accomplish a common purpose. Today, let me give to you bad alliance and good alliance. Today, we look at a bad alliance, it does more harm than good. This happened in the life of Solomon. He married hundreds of women from other countries in order to have a military alliance, a national alliance with the country. By the end of the day, the influence of the woman lead him to unfaithfulness to God. In fact, he even worshiped and offered sacrifice to other gods. His alliance causing a downfall in his life and caused the nation of Israel to split into two. Today, we need to know who we are aligning with. Hello, you look at me, I want to eat me up. I got nothing left here, only flesh and bones. Now, you got to be very serious in this. Your alliance you do, myself included. When I go to the nation to preach, myself, I've been a missionary to Philippines in Iloilo in 86 to 91. So those who are Ilongo, bless your heart. Those who are not Ilongo, God bless you. So we need to know who our alliance is. Bad alliance, that's it, kubush. Gone with the wind. Whether in the church, whether in the work, whether in your friends, we need to know who we align with. If we look at the New Testament, we got good alliance. New Testament is full of alliance with individual with a common purpose. We see the life of Paul that he began to say to Timothy, and he said to the Philippian church, but I trust the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly. Then I also may encourage you when I know your state, for I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state, for all seek their own, not the thing which are Christ, but you know his proven character, that is the son of his father, and he served me in the gospel. Here is a man, Paul. He recommends Timothy. He's a man, this guy is a good quality. This guy is a genuine believer. His interest of his welfare for you, O Philippians church, I submit him to you. He invested his life on Christian there. He's supportive and encouraging to them all. I'm sending Timothy. This is my alliance with him. I'm sending him to you. Alliance apostasy. What is apostasy means? Departure from biblical practice, also known as also the rebellious conscience abandonment to the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. It was the wrong alliance that leads to apostasy to the nation of Israel. Today we are living in the last days, and in the last days, we got to be very clear in what the Bible says. Number one is forsook God's word. You look in Judges chapter 2, we follow Judges 2, leave your Bibles open, and it says here, and you shall not make no covenant with inhabitants of the land, and you shall tear down their altar, but you did not obey my voice. Why have you done this? Wow, it's a very strong word. You never hear my voice, God says. They should have known better, brother. I'm talking to you, brother. They should know better because they have the covenant of God. Joshua just passed away. They knew what God had done. The generation outlived Joshua. So now God is saying, come, you have to align yourself with the word of God. Myself included, yourself included, church. If we don't get the word of God in line in our life, we go habes, finish. The word of God was not their priority in their life. So what happened when the word of God not priority in their life? In Judges chapter 2 verse 10, the Bible says, after the generation, another generation, had they do not know the Lord, nor what God have done. They failed to teach the next generation. It is our responsibility to teach the next generation what God has done in our nation. For you as a church, I do not know idea, no idea at all, brother. Please forgive me, I share from my heart. No idea on what happening in this church. But you and I, we need to teach the next generation how God built this church. Amen. You fail to teach them, man, God, you and I are answerable to the Lord. You cannot say amen, say ado sakit sekali. The Lord, remember, the Lord lead them from Egypt to the promised land. The thing they were obligated to avoid and the things they were compelled to do. The word of God should be the true marker in your life. I'm saying to you, I'm not saying to myself, this message is from me. Not for you, but for me. This is to say the truth and biblical principle has to be applied accordingly. If this Bible, the book, if this word of God depart from your mouth, do not have your word in your heart, in the name of Jesus, we will go backward. Church, we will end up believing every lie. Think about it. Look at the amount of lies that we are hearing every day. Something, somehow, we end up entertaining it, and eventually we believe it. I often go to Indonesia. So I was, the last trip to Indonesia, I was troubled in my heart, brother. I was troubled in my heart after hearing the wrong doctrine that is happening in Indonesia. So I tell myself, hey, brother, when I come the last trip, that's when I came back. I say, I want to interact with you, but why is it so? Why is it so? He said, brother, it's very sad. So this is the issue. This man of God, a mega church in Indonesia, and he came up with a doctrine, all right? For example, me and my wife, all right? And my wife has is married spiritual husband with another person. Me, married spiritual wife with another person. I said, doctrinally, it's totally wrong. And that doctrine was carried in the church. And the denomination hate began to, big churches, they began to gather together. They began to speak to the pastor. And the pastor is 47 years old. And the pastor say, well, for all of you, you are all in the valley. I am seeking atas. I'm in the revelation of the revelation. You guess what happened, brother? Oh, God, wipe him out. 47 years old, he died. The whole church split into two. And I bring fear in my heart. And I say, why is this? He said, yeah, you're all in the valley. You don't have the revelation like mine. Man, my heart, I think through. And I began to say, but yet even the doctrine was not pressed through the nation. But yet it's in the mind of the people that they believe this. Hopefully the next generation do not carry the doctrine out to the next generation. Then I say, no, we need to go back to the word of God. Let the word of God begin to speak to our hearts. That is why G.K. Chesterton say, when men stop believing God, they don't believe in nothing. They don't believe in nothing. They end up believing anything. That is why today God is saying to Israel, forsook not God's word. Hebrews, back up Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. My people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. And because you have rejected knowledge, I rejected you from being the priest for me, because they have forsaken the law of your God and also forget your children. I myself need to know the word of the Lord. You know, brother, when I was doing the study of the book of Habakkuk, not Bakutea, Habakkuk. We're doing the book of Habakkuk, chapter 1 to chapter 3. And I did chapter 1, brother Joseph, I did chapter 1, the first part. And I got people come and say to me, Pastor, it's so difficult to understand. I say, yes, I know it's difficult to understand, but God wants us to go into the whole book of Habakkuk. And after we finish Habakkuk, at last they say, yeah, in wrath remember mercy. I say, yes. But then I remember the life of Moses. Every time the people come to Moses and complain to Moses, I did what Moses did. I bring all the requests of the people. I bring it to the Lord. Lord, this is your problem, not my problem. So I bring the problem to the Lord. I say, God, your people are complaining that the word of God is very hard to understand. Lord, you want me to teach, you got to help me. You don't help me, I'm gone. So I bring to the Lord in prayer, and the Lord speak to me, sister, and he said, you know my people. My people, when comes to their education, as being a doctor, a lawyer, a professor, promoter, or high achievement academic endeavor, they will come to the pastor and say, can you pray for me, sir? You know why? I need to pass my exam. Why they need to pass? So they can get the gaji atas kan? They can get promotion, they can get bonus, they can get the perk, everything they want. They never come to the pastor and say, Pastor, it's so difficult in studying medicine. Can you pray that God will close the door? They never pray close the door. They say, open the door, open the window, open the earth, everything open. But when it comes to the word of God, they complain too hard. You take so long to say amen. You laugh, I just slice you. You see, when coming to our own achievement of our endeavor, we pray, pastor pray. When coming to the word of God, we give thousands of excuses. Number two, what's the cause of apostasy, man-centered and not Christ-centered? This, I'm speaking to you, speaking to myself. Lord, this is your house and you're welcome. Jesus is not a Kung Fu Panda. He will not break in here and say, I'm the boss unless we invite him in. He is a gentleman. In Judges chapter 2, verse 10, look at here. Let's read again. Let's interact the scripture. When all the generation have gathered to their fathers, another generation rose after them that did not know the Lord, not the works of the works which he have done for Israel. Then the Israel, children of Israel, did evil in the sight and served Baal. You go back to the scripture again. After the death of Joshua, chapter 10, verse 11, the people decide to go back and serve Baal. They have seen all the things that God have done. Are they centered upon God or are centered upon Joshua? We need to put our faith in Jesus Christ. Christ must be the center, not man. Thank God for the anointing. But we will not live here forever. My days are limited on this earth. Your days are limited on this earth. We seek after man. If man mampos, you also die. We seek God. God muse man. But Christ is the greatest. Man will fail you. God will never fail you. Man will have shortcoming. God has all the resources in the world. We put our focus on God and Jesus. And Jesus is the center of our life. I remember in our time when the Lord led me to begin to pioneer this work. And I was struggling in my heart and pioneering in the work of God. I said, God, I've been all the while as an evangelist. You send me to Papua, interior, I will go, oh God. But Lord, pastoring a church, I'm not interested. I'll be very honest to you. I'm not interested. Not interested in the title, not interested in this. I said, God, I'm not interested. So one day, and as I began to pray, the Holy Spirit came in a prayer meeting, and the Lord said very cutely, he said, son, I know you're not interested. Sometimes the Holy Spirit speaks very full of wisdom. I know you're not interested. Very gently. But can you do it for me? Nothing to say. So when I was praying, the Holy Spirit said unto me, and the Lord opened my heart, He spoke to my heart, and I says, "Your son," He says, "I'll be the center of this church." I say, "Yes, Lord." And I say, "Lord, you're the center," then I stand here. I say, "Then you become the center." I remember one time, brother, in Jogja, we have the best Holy Spirit meeting in that place there. The anointing of God began to flow right through. And then my interpreter was on my left and I was on the right side. And as I began to worship the Lord, I just felt in my heart the presence was too strong. I pushed my platform. I can't push it here, brother, because all the obstacle, if not, we got obstacle course. So in the end, I pulled my platform to my right. I pulled all the way to the right of the platform. It's quite a large platform. I turned around and looked for my interpreter. He pushed his platform right to that left. How we did it by the Spirit of God, I got a monitor here. And then I said, "Thank you, Lord, for the monitor." I hear myself. He preached without nobody standing in the center. And after the whole meeting was gone, the key person in charge, he said, "Pastor, I'm very surprised that you did this." He said, because he was the first speaker, I was the 10th speaker after 10 days of meeting. Then he said, "Do you know he also did the day on the first day the same manner? And I did the same I did on the lab. I was in different city, came back to Jogja." He said, "When you stand there and preach right there," he said, "the Lord spoke to him the same thing, because that moment the presence of God was there. Nobody stood in the center. Everybody stood at the side. The presence of God was awesome in the place. Glory to God. That's why I said unto you, I tell myself, if God move, I move back. I don't want to be kekyang to stand in the center." Many times we want to fiddle our hands and try to do the work of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit said, "Donnie, one more time, I chop off your hand." You laugh at it because the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart. In a today church, you look at the life. Today church, you are more persistently clinging to man-made idea and man-centered methodology instead of Christ-centeredness. Hold on first. Don't throw your Bible at me. Unless you got handphone, nice one, you throw at me. Let me qualify my statement. Let me qualify, sir. I'm not saying that throwing out man methodology is wrong. What I'm saying is we need to go back to the old time Pentecostal, going down our knees, intense prayer, asking God, "Lord, what we need to do for this thing, oh God." "Oh, Pastor, we have done this before." Yes, God says, "I know, but can you pray again and I give you more details?" Yes. Only this side, amen, that side, "Oh, what's happening?" Come on. The Lord's been speaking to our hearts. God is speaking to you. God is speaking to us. The Lord is speaking and saying to you and me, look at it. God wants us, oh God. Methodology is good. Man, idea is good. But God's idea is much more better. Amen. God's idea, when you begin to fast and pray, seek the Lord, ask the Lord, pray through until God began to speak. We cannot copy and paste. Very quiet. You sister, I talk to you. Then forgive them, oh God. We cannot copy and paste. God said, "One more time, copy." I copy and paste your face. Come on, we cannot copy and paste. There are times that we need to wait upon the Lord. You and I struggle in many ways. I got many, many struggles. More struggle than all you put together. Many times I had to pray, "Lord, what shall I do?" One day the Lord said unto me, open my eyes. He said, "Son, when I turn the page, you follow. If I don't turn the page, you don't follow." Then I said, "Lord, turn the page. Give me a scripture verse." Then the Holy Spirit says, "Son, remember, they are cloud by day and the fire by night." Yes, amen. They move, I move. They don't move, I stay. Amen. Your amen, very kurang, very soft. Come on. Because we always think you got to do, you got to do, you got to do. God says, "I know you got to do." God says, "I got you to stay there, wait." Amen. Make sure you also learn to listen to what God is saying. That shows that these other people are sight-based people. They serve Baal. Sight. They remember the generation that outlived Joshua. They saw the fire by night and cloud by day. They're moved by the Spirit of God. Now, they are sight-based people. Their belief was to walk by sight and not by faith. The Bible says you have to walk by faith and not by sight. Amen. So the Pharisee and the Sadducees came to Jesus and say, Lord, show us a sign. Because they are governed by sign. I believe in sign. Jesus say unto the Pharisee, no sign shall be given unto you but the sign of Jonah. So, when we are not Christ-centered, we look for a sign. Let's pray again. You all look at me very angry. Father, I ask of your grace and mercy upon my life. I ask of you, Lord, as I speak your word in truth, in the name of Jesus, cover me with the blood of Jesus, I pray. Amen. You know, there are many Christians that are looking at signs. The sign is not bad, but it does. If you seek a sign and not Jesus Christ, then you will get another sign. Yeah. Unwilling to change. They forsook the God of their fathers. Then the father brought them out of Egypt. They follow other gods, and among them, when all around they bow down, they provoke the God to anger. What caused God to be angry? I believe in my heart as I read the book of Judges, there was a persistent inobedience to what God is saying. You go back to Judges chapter 2, verse 1, follow me in the Bible. The angel of the Lord said unto them, did not I bring you Egypt to from Gilgal to Egypt? You got to go back to chapter 2, verse 1. If you look at chapter 3, chapter 2, verse 13, 14, they forsook the Lord and served Baal and Ashtoreths. Anger of the Lord was shot against Israel. He delivered them to the hands of the plunder, and who despoiled them and sent them to the hands and sent and sold them to the hands of the enemy all around, and they could no longer stand before the enemy. Look at that word there. It's a thought that comes to my mind, brother. God is the one that sold them. Hey, brother, we live in grace, man. You're going to fight with God in Scripture. All things work for His purpose. All things work. You got to know what God is saying in your life. So I need to walk circumspectly before God. I need to walk humbly before God. Every of us, our situation are different. So we need to look to the word of the Lord and God. It was not just an immediate act. I believe it was an act that God was saying from then to then. After Joshua lived for 110 years, maybe 110 years. It was a 100, I give grace 110 years, you still cannot obey me, I knock your head. Sorry, I speak this way, Pastor. I speak English. Right? Look at the length of time God has given to them. And you look back and in Joshua chapter 2, Judges chapter 2, and the angel of the Lord spoke this word to all the children of Israel. They lifted up their voice and wept. They wept in verse 2, verse 4. Right? Follow me. Verse 12 and 13, balik lagi. They go back to and worship Baal. You think they need a slap from the Lord? Sure. Hello? They were rebuked by Yahweh. There was a huge amount of weeping. We will conclude that that would be a great genuine repentance right here. But it did not happen. They should have stood up, repent, go back, and wipe the enemies. We will assume that this is the case. Unfortunately, this is not the case. So, they still go back. The place is called Bochim. Hokkien say Bosim. And crocodile tears. If there is a spirit of genuine repentance, weeping, they would have forsaken. They would not have forsaken the faith of their fathers. You know, this tells me, as we grow in age and spirituality, we used to get things done the way we used to. Change is wise when the old ways are doing sometime, something can be done better. Myself included. I'm talking about myself. You're still young. I'm still younger. To fulfill the purpose that God has for us. You know, church, there are many non-Christian who can tell the story of Adam, Eve, Noah, Jonah. They can tell you the stories of the cross and the resurrection, but yet their lives are not changed. So the Christian life is to be a life of constant change when we get better and better at pleasing God, loving Him with all our heart and loving our neighbor as ourselves. As somebody say, nobody becomes a Christian without change. Nobody becomes a growing Christian without more change. Israel history repeats. Across the scripture, they remain in that state all because they refuse to change. Myself included, I need to change what God is saying to me. Like I say to you, my struggle. When the Lord say, Pastor, work, I say, Lord, I'm not interested. God say, no, this is your work. No, Lord, fight with God. Fight with God. At the end of the day, the Lord wins. Yeah, the Lord is very patient and very loving. Thank God He did not slice me. I believe God today is saying to you, hello, you're very tense there. I feel your tension. Judges chapter 22, verse 20. The anger of the Lord was hot against Israel because this nation transgressed my covenant. I commanded fathers and did not heed to my voice. I believe God speaks to us not only in the time of worship. God speaks to us the preaching of the word. God speaks to you in the reading of your word. God preaches to you when you pray. I believe God speaks to you. Everybody wants to hear, but how many body want to do? Every time believers say, Pastor, pray, what God is saying. I don't know what God is saying. You want to go read your Bible, Genesis to Revelation. And everything that God has spoken to us, we need to obey. In His time, He'll cause it to come to pass. Amen. Not ASAP. We live in a digital society ingrained in our hearts. We want it now. God said, no way, man, now. You are not ready to handle. There's molding in our life, character in our life. And then when we become mature, when all that we do, God receives the glory, not us. It is only unto Him. And church, and the Lord began to speak to my heart, son, if the day that you began to not glorify, I will walk out of the church. Man, I fear in my heart, sister. I said, Lord, you be the center of the church. Not only we sing the song, God be the center, but you be the center. We can sing it from our mind. We can sing it from our heart, but our spirit, nothing to do with Jesus in the center. That's a very scary thing, to not walk in the perfect will of the Lord. That is why in number 4, they lost the freedom their fathers enjoyed. The angel of the Lord came from Gilgal to Bochim. Follow the word, Gilgal to Bochim. I have led you from Egypt and brought you to the land I swore to your father. God kept His promise. Oh, nobody. Brother, God kept His promise. I got one amen. That's good. Thank you. One amen enough already. Chukup. God kept His promise. I do not know the history of this church, but God kept His promise for this church. From the day till now, whatever it is, God kept His promise. We can falter in many ways. I also faltered in many ways. But God kept His promise. Amen. He never withdrew His promise, but He chastised us to fulfill His promise. Not your promise, not my promise, but His promise in our life. That's why the chastisement of the Lord. Hello, welcome to church. Don't think I'm not chastised. You never see any wings around me, right? So, okay, we are fair. Amen. Thank you, brother, for smiling. You ease my heart, brother. The rest all like garam sekali. Hold on first. Hold on first. Wait first. Verse 5. I enjoy myself here. The angel of the Lord came. Let us investigate. Let us investigate Gilgal. I say investigate. Pastor, they all look at me like, what, investigate me? What happened in Gilgal? Gilgal is Israel cross over the Israel crossed over Jordan River, came in Gilgal. Then we see Joshua set up 12 stone in Gilgal. Then circumcised took place in Gilgal. And Passover celebrated in Gilgal. Wow, this is a blessing from the Lord. Now I get your feeling. Oh, okay. Now you all are like, wow, very angry with me. Hold on first. A lot of things happen in Gilgal. When the Lord writes Gilgal, that he has spiritual significance. Verse 14. Chapter 2, verse 14. Anger of the Lord was set against Israel, delivered them and plunder. And he says here, they could not stand at the, they could not stand longer, long before the enemies. Verse 16. Then nevertheless, oh merciful God, nevertheless he raised up judges who delivered them out of the hands of those who plundered them. God was very merciful, he raised up judges. We should not be surprised to this scripture. God specifically promised this we will do to the covenant he made with Israel, which he depicted in the Bible in the book of Leviticus and Deuteronomy. You do this, you obey me, I bless you. You don't, you keep on doing that is wrong, I will punish you and the curse of God come upon you. Clear cut. You know, this tells me they enjoy, they lost the joy of their fathers. I'm thinking through much. We must not forget the spiritual fathers who lay the cornerstone in the nation of Singapore. The first missionary that came, that plowed the land, and they reap. They may not reap so much, but they sowed the seed. Their purpose, they sacrifice. We become the recipient of the blessing. We don't forget our spiritual fathers. And if this generation don't walk in line with God, we end up in the same shoes like the nation of Israel. That is why you have to always reinforce and tell them how our spiritual fathers have built. Let's walk in it. This reminds me of Pearl Harbor. It's a dramatic retelling the story of December the 7th, the battle. The Japanese launched a surprise attack at U.S. naval base in Hawaii. In the battle, Japanese damaged 8 battlefield battleship, 13 other vessels, estimated of 200 planes, an estimated of 3,000 military personnel who were killed and wounded. And later on, they came up with a Memorial Day, remembering the day of Japanese attack Pearl Harbor. This helps them to remember the challenges and the victory of their past. And later on, they attack Japan. But looking at this scripture tells me we need to enrich our commitment, our sacrifice, remain faithful to the spiritual heritage, and focus on the future, what God has. Unless we walk away in apostasy, they fail. We need to raise up a generation that will be blessed. You and I are blessed. The next generation will be blessed much more, lest they lose the freedom that we have. We teach them to be strong in faith, walk in faith. The COVID that divided the church. I always tell people, I say, not happy with me, not happy, no problem. I say, brother, COVID is not the last say in your life. Jesus Christ is the last say in your life. If you want to mampos, you mampos already. You die already, finish. It's time for you to stay, you stay. God has a final say. We're still fighting about vaccine. Come on, wake up, move, save soul. I'm not scolding you, I'm just talking to you, brother. Right? We're still back in the old days. We need to move forward. Hey, God will give us life. God say, I give you life. Serve, Lord, give me life. Lord, I pray I will not die, but I declare the glory of God. Let's move. And seeing the mission trip, amen, praise the Lord. They went, right? They came back, right? I only know some, brother. Oh, yeah. They went, right? They came back, right? Amen. Did they die? No. That shows you need to go. Amen. Come on, you need to go. You say amen, amen, but you never go. Ah, chalaka. Ah, never appreciate God's goodness. Just give me time, brother. Thank you, sir. Judges chapter 2. Verse 17, 18. Yet they will not listen to their judges. But they played the harlot with other gods and bowed down to them. They turned quickly from the ways in which your fathers walk in obedience in the commandment of the Lord. They did not do so. And the Lord raised up judges for them. The Lord was with the judges. And deliver them out of the hands of the enemies all the days of the judges. For the Lord was moved with pity by the groaning because of those who oppressed them and harassed them. Hold on first, sir. The Lord raised up judges, the Lord raised up leaders, the Lord raised up governors, the Lord raised them up. They did not appreciate God's goodness. God's goodness was seen in the judges. The judges were raised by God, not by men. They did not appreciate. It seems to imply that they have itching ears, 1 year in, 1 year out. When the judges died, they went back and did worse. Open your Bible together. I show you the scripture. When the judges died, they went back and did the worst. Judges chapter 2, verse 19 on the screen, not on the screen. Right in your Bible. Open your Bible with me, your electronic phone. All right, look at verse 19. The Bible says, and it came to pass when the judges have died, they reverted and behaved more corruptly than their fathers. This is very scary. When the judges died, they went back. Never appreciate God's goodness. We should be very thankful God raised up leaders in the church. Leaders are not perfect. Just like you. Oh, nobody. I talk to you, brother. Leaders, I'm also not perfect, brother. I'm not perfect. But God raised up leaders. God lays up leaders and anoint them for the purpose. But actually, they are same believers like you. Same plateau, same platform. Only the task is given and the anointing and position. The rest of it's same. You're saved by the same blood of the Lamb of God. Amen. Now, amen. Amen. The rest never say, Father, forgive them, they hear it not, O God. All right. God raised up leaders, chastise them. Let me give you the lack of a fighting spirit. Let me close with this. Lack of a fighting spirit. Judges chapter 22, verse 20. Judges chapter 2, 20. The anger of the Lord, follow me in the scripture. Our heart again, Israel, because the nation had transgressed my covenant, which I command their fathers, and they have not heed to my voice. Again, you see, pause here for a while. Again, you began to see the word of God. As I read that again, I read so many times, now I'm reading to you again. I'm seeing so many things there. Again, you see in verse two, chapter 2, verse 1, you did not hear my voice. Again, you see, you did not hear my voice. Again, you never hear my voice. Again, it be repeated again. You never hear my voice. Look at it. He says here, you did not heed my voice. I also will no longer drive them before you if any nation with Joshua left when he died. And so that through them I may test Israel. God put them on a test. Another scripture, go back to Judges chapter 3, verse 1 to verse 2. And now the nation the Lord left that might test Israel to them. That is, you can read that scripture. Look at me. The apostate generation lack a fighting spirit. Unlike the former generation, they cling to the promise and claim the land. We must not forget the sacrifice of the former generation that have made. We hear stories about sacrifice of the former generation missionaries and ministers to toil the ground. But yet, let me say it unto you, we need to have the same tenacity in our life today. We got everything that we need in this nation. What we need is a tenacity to press on. Nobody say it's easy. I'm saying we need God's grace, God's mercy, God's strength. You know, when I was in America, I was a deep sea diver. And I went from New York City, went to Florida, did amateur diving. And I got my friend who was a diver. He was an ex-Green Beret at a big crack here up there. I mean, a bit singing, a bit. I talked to him, I know a few of them all a bit out here. But they would dive, and I like to ask them, hey, tell me about your Vietnam story. They tell me all the Vietnam story of the Green Beret, Special Forces. I mean, to them, it's like chopping a chicken is as easy as killing a man. I mean, that kind. They just like flip over. But anyway, when hearing the stories and that experience, when we hear the stories of missionaries, let me go backward. When we hear the stories of ex-Green Beret Special Forces, they learn from their experience in the battlefield so that the next bunch of Green Berets will not do the same mistake and get killed in the battlefield. So we learn from the former missionaries how they toil, how they learn, how they survive, how they walk through so that we will not make the mistake and we will survive in serving God. Unless, if we don't know who we are, nor where we come from, or what we are called for, and do not know where to go, we will end up in Judges chapter 2, verse 10. I humbly submit this to you, not in an arrogant way. Please, I submit to you. And the generation that gathers another generation that did not know the Lord. Let us stand to our feet. Yes, O Lord. Let's quiet our hearts unto the Lord. I did not know the history of this church. I humbly submit to the leadership. Thank you for this time. I lay the word of God that God have laid upon my heart to share with you. What's going on, I have no idea. What, as far as I know, the Lord have given me that message. I fear to preach this message, the apostasy. And speaking to myself. But I believe today, God is saying to us, align ourselves with Him. In alignment with Him. When God speaks, we heed to His word. If we don't heed to the word, how the Lord will bring us to the plunder, I don't know how He do. It's not for me to know how He do. I only want to walk in fear of the Lord and have mercy. And I believe today, God has spoken to you, all eyes closed and all head bowed. You say, Pastor, pray for me. God has been speaking to my heart. God saying to me, appreciate the goodness of the Lord. Appreciate, I lack the fighting spirit. I need to change. I need to not forsake the word of God wherever you are standing. I believe God has spoken to you. I want you to come and make this altar and an altar prayer before the worship team lead us in a song. And the leaders will help together with me. We'll pray together with you in the name of Jesus. Come right now. We'll not take much time. You come. Yes, you come. Find a place at the altar. I believe God has spoken to you. Don't wait for one another. You don't please me. I speak from my heart. I say to you the word of God. Unless you begin to heed to the word of the Lord, unless you heed to the word of God, I'm speaking to myself, we will miss the plan and the purpose the Lord has. Lead us, sister.
A pure heart, that's what I long for. A heart that follows after Thee. A pure heart, and that's what
What a powerful, powerful word. We must be certain where we are heading, and we must be prepared for the change as we grow. Amen. Next week, we will continue with the teaching from the book of James, and Brother Cecil will be ministering to us, sharing on the attitude towards wealth. Now, would you lift up your hands to receive the benediction? May the love of our God the Father, the anointing of Christ, the Son, and the power and presence of God the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The service is now over. Join us for fellowship downstairs. And please. And the. Okay. And you're not done.